So I'm back with another video talking today about a topic relating to the vaccine-induced autoimmunity. The data that I'm going to share with you today is based on this textbook called Vaccines and Autoimmunity. Okay? This textbook is the first peer-reviewed textbook on this topic. And this is a collaboration from 77 different universities and a small amount of medical clinics from around the world, excluding the United States. So this textbook has a tremendous amount of research over decades in relationship to how vaccines could induce autoimmune conditions. And today I'm just going to share with you some real interesting data in this book. Now, before I get into it, there's a syndrome that was recently kind of defined called ASIA, autoimmunity / inflammation syndrome induced by adjuvants. Now, what's an adjuvant? Well, in this case, an adjuvant is something that enhances the immune response. Because if you're going to use a synthetic viral particle in a vaccine or some type of genetic resequencing of a virus, instead of the actual live virus or a dead whole organism, the immune response is a lot less, so they have to add into a vaccine an adjuvant. And aluminum hydroxide is the only approved adjuvant in the United States. So let's just take a look at some interesting data in this book. All right, the first thing is this book called Vaccines and Autoimmunity is a result of decades of experience in vaccinology, immunology, and autoimmunity. So it goes on to talk about how individual vaccines can trigger autoimmune disease in susceptible individuals. And right from the very start, they're saying, in this regard, the fact that vaccines are delivered to billions of people without preliminary screenings for underlying susceptibility is thus of concern. Absolutely it is. For example, it has been shown that the vaccine for Lyme disease is capable of triggering arthritis in genetically susceptible hamsters, and that when an adjuvant aluminum hydroxide is added to the vaccine, 100% of the hamsters develop arthritis. That's not good. You have to make sure that you do not vaccinate your hamsters with adjuvants. All right, check this out. Notably, in 1982, compelling evidence from clinical and animal research emerged to show that Guillain-Barré syndrome, it's an autoimmune disease, and other demyelinating autoimmune neuropathies. Those are conditions where the myelin sheath that protects the nerve is destroyed, as in MS, could occur up to 10 months following vaccination. Now, in other parts of this book, they get into it could be a lot longer, so this delayed reaction. In such cases, the disease would first manifest with vague symptoms. Arthralgia, which is like joint pain, myalgia, which is muscle pain, paresthesia, which is nerve problems, and weakness, all which are typical of this condition right here, which were frequently deemed insignificant and thus ignored by the treating physicians. However, these symptoms would progress slowly and insidiously until the patient was exposed to a secondary immune stimulant in the form of either infection or vaccination. This would then trigger the rapid and acute clinical manifestation of the disease. In other words, it was the secondary immune response that would bring about an acute overt manifestation of an already present subclinical long-term persisting disease. These manifestations pointed to a subclinical slowly evolving disease. Whether this disease would eventually progress to its full-blown clinical apparent form depended on whether the individual was further exposed to an immune stimulus, including subsequent vaccinations. As a case in point, we recently described 6 cases of systemic lupus following the HPV vaccination. A casual glance at the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, CDC, 2013, immunization schedule for infants shows that according to the U.S. prescribed guidelines, children receive up to 19 vaccinations during their infancy. The various vaccines given to children, as well as adults, may contain either the whole weakened infectious agent or a synthetic version and genetically engineered antigens of infectious agents and adjuvants, typically aluminum. What is obvious, nonetheless, is that a typical vaccine formulation contains all the necessary biochemical components to induce autoimmune manifestations. Physicians need to be aware that in certain individuals, vaccinations can trigger serious and potentially disabling or even fatal autoimmune manifestations. Finally, we wish to encourage efforts towards developing a safer vaccine which could be pursued by the vaccine manufacturing company. Now, there is some real great data, I'm going to put it down below, that they're doing research right now on using inulin, which is a fiber, which can act as an adjuvant, which has significantly less side effects than aluminum hydroxide. Now, in chapter two, they're talking about a concept called molecular mimicry. Okay, so of course I have this textbook right here, Molecular Mimicry, Infection-Inducing Autoimmune Diseases. Fascinating book. What this is about is describing a phenomenon that a pathogen, like a virus, has a certain genetic code or sequence that can mimic our own body tissue or specific parts of our body tissue. The virus from the measles can mimic the myelin sheath around our nervous system. The rabies virus has a similarity to the insulin receptor. Papilloma virus also is similar to the insulin receptor. Then we have the herpes simplex virus, which can mimic the acetylcholine receptor. Now, what's significant about that? There's a condition called myasthenia gravis, which is an autoimmune disease, which has antibodies to the acetylcholine receptor. Then we have the coxsackie virus, which is similar to myosin, which is a protein in muscle. So what is the significance of this? If someone has repeated exposure to an infection, a pathogen, or a vaccine, this potentially causes a cross-reactivity and triggers an autoimmune condition to your myelin or to the insulin receptor, as in type 1 diabetes, or the acetylcholine receptor, as in myasthenia gravis, or a protein in the muscle, creating antibodies to your own muscles. And lastly, I want to touch a little bit on chapter 4. And they're talking about how aluminum adjuvants can penetrate the blood-brain barrier, actually traveling through the macrophage. This then causes a buildup of aluminum in the brain, and collectively these findings also explain in part why the majority of reported adverse reactions following vaccinations with adjuvants are neurological and neuropsychotic with underlying immunoinflammatory or autoimmune components. Nonetheless, according to Kahn, 2019, continuous increasing doses of the poorly biodegradable aluminum adjuvant may become insidiously unsafe, especially in cases of repetitive, closely spaced vaccinations, otherwise known as vaccine rechallenge. And lastly, there are three main risks involved with this adjuvant aluminum. It can persist in the body up to 11 years following the vaccination. Number two, it can trigger pathological responses. And number three, it can make its way into the central nervous system where it can drive further immunoinflammatory reactions. And the last thing I want to mention is if you are in a situation where you're forced to get a vaccination, I would recommend to take certain natural compounds to help bind with the adjuvant aluminum to minimize damage control. In the description down below, I put a series of things that I would recommend on that. Thanks for watching. Before you go, if you have a question about a product, or you're new to keto and you want to know how to begin keto, or you're on keto and you need a debug because it's not going as smooth, I have a keto consultant standing by to help you. This is just for the people in the US. Hopefully in the future we'll be able to answer everyone's call, but I put the number down below so you can call and get some help.